Hello, everyone. During the previous learning process, we have acquired a great deal of knowledge about machine learning. So in this section of the video, we will learn many common machine learning algorithms. There is a lot of content, we will make two short videos to introduce it to everyone. First, let's take a look at an overview of machine learning algorithms. In the previous machine learning algorithm classification, we know it can be best into supervised learning, unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning, and reinforcement learning. It's not about missing out on semi-supervised learning and reinforcement learning here, but because they are not particularly common, so in this section, we will discuss common algorithms related to supervised learning and unsupervised learning. Let me introduce everyone. We can see, there are also a lot of algorithms here. In supervised learning, there are classification problems, regression problems. Under the classification problem, there are also a wide variety of algorithms. There are also many algorithms under the topic of regression. The most common ones we may encounter are logistic regression and linear regression. There are also SVM, decision trees, and so on. Of course, they have many algorithms that can be used for classification, can do regression again. Moving on to unsupervised learning, there are clustering tasks and some other types of tasks. In clustering, the most common method we use is K-means. There are hierarchical clustering, density clustering, and even spectral clustering. Other algorithms, such as PC, it is an algorithm for dimensionality reduction, and our Gaussian mixture model. When performing some speech processing tasks, this kind of model is commonly used. So next we will focus on the relatively simple algorithms in it. Let me introduce everyone. First, let's talk about linear regression. I believe in every course that teaches machine learning, it will start with linear regression, because it is the most fundamental, the simplest, the most practical and commonly used machine learning algorithm. So linear regression, it is using regression analysis and mathematical statistics to determine the relationship of interdependence between two or more variables. Simply put, it is to find such a straight line, of course, in the high-dimensional space. It may be a flat surface, in two-dimensional space, it is just a straight line, fit the existing data distribution. Don't worry about whether it can be completely done, perfectly fit your data distribution, but linear regression, it's as simple as using a line or a surface, fit your data distribution. This page displays a mathematical formula for our linear regression. Right here, add W to F. The most basic mathematical formula, W represents weight, B represents bias, X is the feature of the sample input, it's just that simple. How to obtain such a linear regression model? Right here we use such a loss function. We still remember the loss function we talked about in our last video, is the stochastic gradient descent used for fitting. Here is where this loss function is utilized. Minimize its loss function value. We can obtain our best linear regression model. Here, as long as the loss value is minimized, you can get the best model. For linear regression, we have an expanded content. It is polynomial regression. Everyone can find a clue from the mathematical formula. Traditional linear regression is adding this item to that item. Polynomial linear regression has this additional term, this item, and this item. In the middle, it represents that there are many of this represents a lot of expressions. Polynomial linear regression, its main feature is the presence of this x to the power of n term. Referring to the diagram on the right, we can see the differences between polynomial regression and our traditional linear regression. When it is to the power of 5, we look at this green line. Does it have a strong sense of fluctuation? Is it very curved? After joining this direction, it will significantly enhance our linear regression with a non-linearity. Here, it can be well reflected in non-linearity. Therefore, this is polynomial linear regression. So, this is polynomial linear regression, one of its improvements. However, polynomial linear regression, the relationship between its weight parameters bubble is still linear. So it is an extension of linear regression. It is an extension of linear regression. For what purpose? In order to supplement the original linear regression model, the states when obvious underfitting occurs. So just use polynomial linear regression, because it has a better non-linearity. How to prevent overfitting in linear regression. Sometimes your data may be very linear. The sample you provided is very linear. It will be prone to overfitting. How to solve this overfitting problem? As we mentioned in our previous videos, here there will be a more accurate introduction. We can add a regularization to, for example, this part and this part. Above here is an L2 regularization. Here is an L1 regularization. Below, L2 regularization. We call it ridge regression. L1 regularization. Call it lasso regression. Added L2 regularization. You can also review the previous videos. When it comes to L1 regularization, we are equivalent to certain features from before. Performed an enhancement and inhibition. Everyone can have a better understanding. Is this the because the parameter here is W, we are equivalent to some features performed an enhancement and inhibition. It has achieved such an effect. In other words, we have selected some features, using only a portion of features to complete the fitting, so it can play a role in preventing overfitting. Okay, that's the end of the basic linear regression. Let's take a look at logistic regression. This is a mathematical formula for logistic regression. Logistic regression, it is a classification model to solve classification problems. It has intricate connections with linear regression. In other words, it is based on linear regression, made a change. What kind of change has been made? Added this sigmoid activation function. This is an activation function. To be precise, what should be the equation of this activation function? It should be this one. 1 plus e to the power of x divided by 1 plus x, or the following equation. It is 1 plus e to the power of x divided by 1. But here, we need to switch this x to linear regression. Wx plus b. Have you obtained this equation? It's about logistic regression. Okay, so we have learned about logistic regression. After a relationship with linear regression, let's take another look. What is the loss function of logistic regression? Here, it is the loss function of logistic regression. It may be more complicated. However, we need to understand one thing. One thing to remember is, we want to obtain the optimal value of logistic regression. We are going to use this loss function for calculation. Then what method to use? Calculated using the maximum likelihood estimation. Then the question here will be, why has this become the largest natural estimate here? Everyone can take a look. What does the Y in front represent? Y represents your true value. So your true value is nothing but 1 or 0. Everyone may have forgotten. Let's take a look at the front. Here, it's nothing more than 1 or 0. The processing result after you pass through the sigmoid activation function, it's nothing more than 1 or 0. So that means, may take this part. It may also take this part. The result it obtains. It's just a matter of what your actual value is, and how much is the difference between your actual value and your predicted value. Why isn't it working here? Because the real value you get is a value close to 1. So at this time we need to find out one of its maximum possibilities. Perform a calculation, using maximum likelihood estimation. So it also says here. Similarly, we can use the gradient descent method to find all its values of W. Why can it be like this? Find the lowest point and the highest point. Isn't it just a reverse process? Can we also find its gradient direction in the same way? Next, let's look at an extension of logistic regression. When it comes to logistic regression, we all know it's a binary classification problem. Can it be extended to multiclassification? Sigmoid function. We all know it will perform a binary classification between 0 and map your original linear line to this middle. Perhaps a point was located from this linear line here. All points higher than that point are classified as one category. Those below this point are classified into another category. This completes a binary classification. How to map it to a multi-classification problem? Multi-class classification problems. We usually use this Softmax function. Just like this, we can have the grapes, orange, apple, bananas are all classified. How was it carried out? Let's continue to look. Softmax regression. Or to put it another way, this function, it is the generalization of logistic regression, suitable for k-classification problems, can be extended to k-classifications, multi-classification. It compresses a k-dimensional arbitrary real number vector, or map it to a k-dimensional real number vector. Each element in the vector is limited to a value between 0 and 1. This is one of its equations, a complex mathematical equation, but we need to pay attention to one point. Its denominator ranges from 1 to k, then an accumulation of this function. Above is this function. At this point, I wonder if anyone has any ideas. Let's move on to the next one. After looking at this picture, I believe that everyone will have a deeper understanding of the complex mathematical formula just now. This is a mathematical function. 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 Although this is a number, however, they are all calculated through a mathematical function. So the equation just now is easily explained. What is the sum of that? Equals 1. Right? So isn't it 1 divided by 0? 0, 9, 0. That's 22 divided by 1. In other words, how does softmax work? We have such a variety of outputs. Output value. It might have started as 2, 3, 4, 1. It doesn't matter. I add them together as a sum. This is a tell. The probability of the first type is 2 out of 10. 1 third, 4, 10 and 1, 10. This is the working mechanism of softmax. Of course, this is a simplest example. The specific calculation process needs to apply the formula on the previous page slide. Just through such a simple example here, introduce how the softmax function works to everyone. Next, let's look at the third algorithm in this section. It's the decision tree algorithm. The decision tree algorithm is a milestone algorithm in machine learning. Very important. It is an algorithm based on a tree structure. Each of its non-leaf nodes represents a test on a feature attribute. Actually, this node is a feature. This node may represent a feature of this child. This node is called the chirping feature. This node represents the feature of the neck. So at this point, you need to test this node to perform classification, satisfying certain characteristic properties. You can start branching for him. Go to the next node for output. Here I believe everyone has a rough idea about decision trees. So many branches for classification. Until reaching the leaf node, then store the leaf node as the decision result. You can see here, short in stature, but it won't squeak. That might be a squirrel. If it squeaks, it's a rat. Then you see that all these leaf nodes have been assigned to a fixed category. Previously it was features. The final leaf node is for classification. That's how the decision tree is completed. Branching on each feature. Branch all the way to the end. One possible outcome for us. This completes a decision tree. So this is the structure of the entire decision tree. The three parts are the most important. There is only one root node at the top. So each child node represents many features. The final result represented by all leaf nodes represents a result classification. Result. So what is a key point in building decision trees? Let's take a look at this photo. We just said to classify at the node, child node and root node. How do I classify them? I can't just come up with an idea out of the blue. Then he should have classified it. It is to classify based on information entropy and Gini coefficient. So in the definition above, he is talking about comparing the purity of all partitioning operation results. This purity, we usually use this information entropy and Gini coefficient to serve as a quantitative measure for him. This is one of his formulas here. Formulas for information entropy and Gini coefficient. Everyone can take a look. PK in it indicates the probability of belonging to this category. The greater the difference in purity before and after segmentation, the better the decision tree. What does this represent? Information entropy. Whether it's the Gini coefficient or not, whether it's purity or not, he just keeps expanding. Or the more complex the samples in this category you have, the more chaotic, the larger this value of his. If you have classified one type among this category, only one kind sample, at this time his Gini coefficient will be very small. So we understand now, if I were to classify beforehand, his Gini coefficient is very high. After classification, his Gini coefficient is very small, or his information entropy is very low. So our decision tree is very successful. In other words, from the original messy sample, split into a very clear sample. As a result, my information entropy and Gini coefficient will decrease, so the decision tree I build will be very good. So why are there multiple different quantification indicators of this purity here? It's because we have a variety of different algorithms. Each algorithm adopts different metrics. Next, let's take a look at the construction process of a decision tree. First is feature selection. From the features in the training data, select a feature as the current node. Then evaluate the criteria based on the selected features. Generate child nodes recursively from top to bottom. Once I confirm the first node, I divide according to the first node, possibly two types. It could also be type 3. After the division, I'm using this node again. Or is it that this feature has been exhausted? Isn't it? I removed this feature from the dataset. Using the remaining dataset, that is to say subset, go back and ask him based on which feature to divide. Based on which feature is this subset divided? Based on which feature is this subset divided? Of course, it could all be binary. It could also be a multi-forked number. Building step by step like this, so the construction of the entire decision tree is complete. There will be a pruning process in the middle, because you divided it too finely. Some students may wonder, can I upload my entire decision tree? In the end, I split it into one sample. In this way, are you directly overfitting? Just think about it. If each of your leaf nodes has only one sample, that's overfitting, isn't it? At this time, pruning is actually needed to reduce its structure. He has both pre-pruning and post-pruning. Pruning in advance is when you generate this node. I am about to make a judgment. Do you want to generate? So post-pruning is based on the final generated results. I'll go check again. I want to take a look at which ones. Merge it. Like this. Finally, let's look at a small case of a decision tree. Very simple. In our dataset, we only have three features. Refund, status and this taxable income. Finally, it will be judged whether you will cheat, cheating, deception. So we will classify them based on their different characteristics. Occupies a size of information entropy and Gini coefficient. We went to conduct a branch. Some leaf nodes finally branched too. What conditions do you need to meet? You are indeed likely to cheat. Of course, this is just a very simple example. He has only three characteristics. In a real project, he may have more features, more complex features. You may generate a very large decision tree. These are the first three machine learning algorithms we are going to explain. In the next video, we will continue to explain common machine learning algorithms. Goodbye.